So indeed, this is a work done that has been mainly performed by Joes van Halde, who's a PhD student in our group. But Joes finished last year with his contract, and he has basically everything written down. He just needs to defend his thesis. And this is one of the main outcomes in his thesis, one of the papers. And this is about, the title says multi-level neural networks, although the neural networks themselves are not multi-level, but we use a multi-level methodology in combination with neural networks to solve PDEs with uncertain parameters. So the main reason to look at this type of methods is coming from the need to do uncertainty quantification of, let's say, large-scale physical systems. And a typical example is sloshing. So the work of Joes is from the Sling project, a large Dutch project on sloshing of liquefied natural gas in ships, but also in trucks. This is important. And here you see a simulation, a very academic setting of what sloshing looks like. So I hope the video works for you. So this is a simulation that Joes did with the particle method, smooth particle hydrodynamics, and it gives a bit of an impression of the type of physics that that is involved. And in this Sling project, people are basically interested in the load that the fluid exerts on the walls of a ship. And this determines, for example, the operating envelope of a ship. So when can it go out on sea and transport liquids? But these simulations are rather expensive. So even this simplified setting simulation on the GPU cluster already takes a couple of days. And then if you want to go to real size system and you have to include uncertainties, so that's in the end our main interest. Can we say something about if the movement of a ship is uncertain, or if the initial conditions are uncertain, or if fluid properties are uncertain? How does that affect the loads that are exerted on the cargo containment system of the ship? And of course, this is just one example. You can think of many physical systems that exhibit uncertainties, for example, in climate systems or in other types of energy systems, where you want to know something about, given uncertainties in inputs, how does that affect the outputs? So that's a bit the framework we are in. The UQ framework is we have uncertain inputs that we typically describe by probability density functions. So for example, we can have two different setups for a sloshing impact. They have a slightly different initial condition. And then you see, okay, you already get quite a different outcome in terms of the impact on the ball. So we want to do a lot of these simulations basically with this physical model, and then look at how is the PDF, the probability density function of some output of interest, for example, the loads, but it can be basically any quantity of interest. How is that described? That's sort of the generic UQ framework. Now, in this case, I'm looking a bit more general in the sense that I'm not just interested in the probability density function of the output, but we are looking at a real parametric surrogate model. So a surrogate model means a fast alternative to this expensive physical model, orders of magnitude faster. And how do we do that? Okay, we want to accelerate this part. This part where we have to solve an expensive partial differential equation, this PDE, which is a function of this unknown solution U and uncertain parameters Z. We want to accelerate it with multi-level and machine learning techniques. So this ML in the title stands both for multi-level and for machine learning. And sort of the main driving question in this talk is, can we use our knowledge of PDEs to steer these multi-level and machine learning methods? And the main idea is to learn what we call the error structure between grid levels. And this may sound a bit abstract at this point. So, but that should become clear in this presentation what I mean by that. Okay, first there's the one slide of digression, which is a bit needed sort of for the rest of the talk. So this is about multi-level Monte Carlo methods. So because of this multi-level concept is important in this talk, I want to spend a bit of time on that. So classically, if you want to do uncertainty quantification, maybe you're just interested in the mean of some quantity of interest given uncertainties in the inputs. So you could say, okay, I use a Monte Carlo estimator to estimate the mean of this quantity of interest Q. I draw a lot of samples Z, and then I average them. It's very simple. Okay, when you consider PDE, so when we solve partial differential equations, we basically always have a discretization error because we cannot solve the PDE exactly. So that means we have to approximate this expectation by an expectation of Q on some grid, which I call H. And then and then that expectation is again approximated by Monte Carlo sampling. So in this case, there are two errors. One is the sampling error by using a finite number of samples here. And the other one is the discretization error by going from this expectation of, let's say, the real quantity of interest and the approximation, because we are using a discretization, not approximation of the PDE. Okay, now the idea in multi-level Monte Carlo is to say, let's introduce a sequence of grids. So we're not going to solve the PDE on just one grid, but we're going to introduce a sequence of finer and finer grids and use that to come up with a smarter way of doing Monte Carlo sampling. So for example, let's say we have two grids. One is H, which is the fine grid, and then we have 2H, which is a twice coarser grid. Then this expectation of the quantity of interest on the coarse grid can be written as the sum of two expectations, which is possible because this expectation operator is linear. And so the expectation of Q on the coarser grid plus the expectation of the difference between the two. And now you can independently approximate both these terms with a Monte Carlo approximation. So why would you do that? You could say, okay, I have not gained much, but in fact, you do gain quite a bit because the variance of this second term, the variance of Q on H minus Q on 2H on the coarse, the fine grid minus the coarse grid, is much smaller than the variance of QH. And that means that the number of samples that is needed for this term to be to approximate this term is much smaller than the number of terms that is needed to approximate this one. So that means if you start to refine your grid, you need less samples. And that is of course very beneficial if we want to solve PDEs with uncertain parameters. So that's the basic idea behind multi-level Monte Carlo. So in terms of a picture, we can see it like this. We have a number of grids where we solve a PDE, coarse grid, where we have U1 and the grid X1, and then we successively refine the grid. And then on the finest grid, we have in this case U3, okay, the third grid. And on the finest grid, we need less samples in the parameter space, so that's in Z space. And on the coarse grid, we need many samples, but that's okay because the coarse grid is much cheaper to solve than the fine grid. Now, on the previous slide, I showed you this expansion of the expectation of the quantity of interest on two grids, but in more in general, we can actually also expand the solution. So not only the expectation, but the solution itself, and then on any number of grids basically. So in this case, let's say if we have the solution on U3, we could write it in terms of U1 plus the difference between U2 and U1 and the difference between U3 and U2. So that's this expression, and then these two differences, we're going to write them as errors. So we call this error 2, the difference between these two grids, and this one we call it E3, the third error. This is still definition. We didn't really gain anything. Of course, I should say that in order to subtract these quantities, we need to restrict them to a certain grid, right? So what we do in practice is we restrict the solution on this grid to the locations of this grid. So everything is restricted back to grid one in order to be able to do these type of manipulations. Okay, so the general form of this multi-level expansion, as I said, restricted to coarse grid, then looks like this. So we have the solution on the finest grid, restricted to the coarsest one, is equal to the coarse grid solution plus a sum of differences. So what I called errors in the previous slide. Okay, so here's the definition of the error. That's basically just this term. So this is still about definitions mainly. We didn't do anything fancy. And then we introduce another quantity. So this small e is the relative error between the solutions at two grids. And then I introduce this capital E, which is also an error, but I call it the absolute error because this is defined as the solution at grid I minus the exact solution. So we normally don't know that, but it's going to be useful in the analysis that I will show. And now a main question is, can we say something about this error, this small error E, the relative error, the error between solutions at two grids, if we just know the solution? Okay, you might ask yourself, okay, why is that useful? And sounds a bit like magic. Can you say something about the error if you between two grid levels, if you just have the solution on the coarsest grid? But this is an important concept that we're going to show, that this is actually possible and how it can be used to derive better solutions. So a bit more on PDEs and errors. So now we are going to denote the discretized partial differential equation like this. So in general, this can be a nonlinear equation with, so this L encapsulates all kinds of operations like taking temporal derivatives, spatial derivatives, whatsoever. But we will, for our theory, we will look at the linearized case. In that case, this L is basically just a matrix because we look at the differential equation, which is discretized in space and possibly also in time. And then this L becomes just a matrix. And then in fact, it is possible for linear PDEs to show that there's a relation between this error, this capital E that I showed before, the difference between the solution and the exact solution, which is normally not known, but there's a relation between this capital E, the global error, and a so-called local error, the local truncation error, which is called tau. Well, you could also see this as the definition of tau. Well, why is this interesting? Normally, if we look at if a discretization for our PDE is consistent or accurate, we look at the local truncation error. So we can do a Taylor expansion. So when looking at tau, we normally do Taylor expansions of the exact solution. So we substitute a numerical method in we substitute the Taylor expansion into the PDE, and then we check, is this ordered h squared, is it order h to the power 4, etc., with some derivatives that appear in there. So this term tau is really amenable to analysis. So we can use the tools of classical numerical analysis to investigate what is the order of my method. So that's basically always regarding the local truncation error of the method. However, if you want to say something about the global error of the method, this capital E, then there's the PD operator in between. So you need to be able to bound or say something about this capital L in order to draw conclusions about the global error if you know something about the local error. Okay, that's a bit of background about how we normally work with errors in PDEs in a linear setting. Now let's go back to the question I posed on the previous slide, which is, can we say something about the error if we know just the solution? Which is something that sounds a bit counterintuitive maybe. So I'm going to use an example of a very simple PDE, a diffusion PDE. So we have the second derivative of U given by some source. And in this case, this source is just a sign. And then that makes life very easy because we have the exact solution for U with Dirichlet boundary conditions. And in this case, the solution looks like this. This is the solution with the finite difference method in blue, and there's the exact solution in red. So we can write the discretization like this. So L is a matrix, U is a vector with all the solution values at the different grid points, and F is the discrete representation of this F. And then we define the global error, so the difference between the exact solution and the numerical solution. Sorry, this is the capital E from the previous slide. It's a bit of a notation issue from my side. And we can calculate the truncation error. So officially we can compute that by applying this PDE operator on E. But we can also do Taylor expansions, as I said before. And in principle, that's an infinite number of terms. And now first, here we are just going to show the first term, basically, which is of order delta x squared. So this discretization that I used is delta x squared accurate. And here you see indeed that you have the truncation error that is the most accurate one, the blue one, but which you can normally not compute because you don't know e. But you can approximate it with this tilde based on doing pen and paper work deriving the Taylor expansions of the solution. And you see it's a very good approximation in this case. It's also a very simple PDE, so this is not difficult. But now the main point is that what you could do is you could solve the equation LE equals tau, where tau is approximated by this one, which is not difficult. So this right-hand side is not difficult to derive. So you could say, let's first solve this equation for you. And once we have that, we construct tau, which is straightforward. And then we solve this equation again for E tilde. And this gives us an approximation of the error. And then we update the solution. So we get an updated approximation to U tilde, which is given by U that came from this equation, and E tilde, which comes from this equation. And I say, okay, that sounds too good to be true. But it really works. So you see here that the improved solution is now much closer to the exact one, and to show that also on the log-log plot, it becomes fourth order instead of second order. So that's sort of a simple way in which you can improve your order of accuracy of your method. Well, you solve twice a system of this size of L8. So you don't need to go to a larger system on a finer grid. You stick to the same grid. You do two solutions of this one, and you have a much more accurate solution. But the main observation is that it is possible to express the local truncation error in terms of the solution, and therefore also the global error in terms of the solution. And that was the question that I asked before. So the main observation is the spatial error, capital E, and also the relative error, small e, they are related to this truncation error tau. And the truncation error tau is related to the solution U. So in a diagram, it just looks like this. And then the two connections, the two arrows are what I said, Taylor expansions, partial derivatives, which relate the solution to the truncation error, and then the PDE properties. So in the linear case, this is the equation relates the local truncation error to the global error. Okay, so I hope this is clear. There are still no neural network, but it will come soon. So the idea is now, let's use a neural network to learn this mapping. And why do we want to do that? Well, the explanation that I gave before on this relation between solution, local error, global error holds for linear PDEs only. So it is difficult to extend this to nonlinear PDEs. And also, in fact, this relation that you see here between the global error and the local error, this truncation error, you see that if you know the truncation error, then that actually to get E, that's a very non-linear operation, right? That's the inverse of L. So this is, in fact a non-linear operation to get from tau to E. So the idea is to use a neural network to learn this mapping from the solution to the error. And in fact, we are going to do that in two steps. And that is given by the two steps that we have in this diagram. So first from U to tau, and then from tau to E. So what do we get? We want to get an expression for the error between two grid levels. If we go back to the multi-level context, at the solution at level I and the solution at level I minus one. But we want to express that in terms of a neural network that we call P, which has only the input on the coarsest level. So we want to learn the error between a coarse and a fine grid by using only the solution at the coarse grid, right? And why we can do that, that's what I explained on the previous slide. Okay, the full expression for the high fidelity solution, if you use that, looks like that. So that's a nested sum, looks a bit ugly maybe. It's not that difficult. For example, if you go back to U3 that I showed before, so let's say U, the solution on grid number three is given by the solution on grid one plus the error between two and one and the error between three and two. And then this becomes, is going to be expressed as a neural network as a function of the solution on the coarse level. And then E3 is given by another neural network as a function of U2. And then, okay, you can continue that. So U2 can be expressed again as U1 plus P2. So that is how we come up with this sort of nested sum. Okay, now I already said we're going to split this this relation into two steps. So the first one, from U to TON, we are going to use a convolutional neural network to get this. And why? Well, I said this is the relation between these two, from U to TON, is given analytically by Taylor expansions. And convolutional neural networks are very useful to learn this local spatial behavior. So in fact, you can learn basically finite differences with convolutional neural networks if you train them on that. So you can see that this convolutional stencil that is typically used, you can basically recognize a finite difference stencil in there. So this this spatial structure that you get from a convolutional network is very useful in learning spatial derivatives in the truncation era. Now, and then the second part, from TOR to E, we just use a fully connected neural network because this is a highly nonlinear mapping. So these are the two components that we use. So we basically get our neural network to be inspired by the knowledge that we get from the PDE. And then in between there's TOR, of course, and that is the latent quantity in the network. So if you look from a picture point of view, then the first part, that's the blue part, is the convolutional part. And then that is flattened into one big vector. So the convolution that comes out of this after the input of the coarse grid. And the uncertain parameter Z are added here. And then this is the fully connected part. And then the output is the error. So the input here is the solution on the coarse grid. And the output is the error between that coarse grid and a finer grid. That is what we want to learn. Okay, that was the first part of the PDE-inspired network design. We're now going to add something to this to make it even stronger. And that is the second observation, is that these error fields, so the error between the solution at different levels, they appear to have a similar spatial structure. So say you have the solution, or sorry, you have the error related to two solutions on fine grids, and you have the error between a similar error but then on a coarser grid, then it appears that these errors are the same, these error fields are the same, except for a constant and some order term that is that vanishes when increasing the mesh size. So yeah, okay, you can also sort of prove this. There is some theory on that, though it's pretty old. For linear PDEs, again, for nonlinear, it would be very difficult, but for linear PDEs, an expansion of the solution like this exists for large class of problems, and then this result follows directly. Yeah, this sounds a bit abstract, so I'm going to show you an example. This is a flow which is actually quite nonlinear, the flow over backward-facing step. So that means we have a flow coming in here, flow going out here, and then you get a recirculation zone here and a recirculation zone here. This is the solution for the velocity field. And now we can solve this problem on a sequence of grids. So coarse grid, fine grid, and so on. And then we look at the difference between the solutions on these grids. So that is this small e, the relative error. And then indeed we see that E2, E3 and E4, when you look at how the spatial error structure is basically identical up to a constant scaling factor, this C in the previous slide, right? So this idea is comes from linear PDE theory. There you can prove it, that this is true, but we see here also for already quite a non-linear PDE, the incompressible Navier-Stokes equations, that this is still seems to hold. Okay, what does this bring us? Well, if these error fields are similar on different levels, then we can use the concept of transfer learning to train the subsequent networks. So we start with training a network that goes basically from the first level to the second level. And once we have trained that, we are just going to add, so this is, let's say, the first neural network, at the convolutional part, the fully connected part. And then the second, the next neural network that maps between the solution at level two to level three, we just add a number of layers to the end of this network, and we keep the rest fixed. So we fix the weights and biases of the previously trained network, and we add a number of a small number of fully connected layers at the end, and we only need to train these ones. Okay, so the entire algorithm now starts looks like this. So we first take samples of our uncertain parameter Z, and we split them in training and validation set. We do sort of classical standard cost minimization of the network. So we tune the weights and biases. We do hyperparameter tuning. So in our case, that means the number of layers in the network, regularization parameter. And then we iterate this. So we check if the network is able to match the validation set. And if not, then we increase the number of samples in this set. And this is iterated. And then at some point, if this if the neural network from going between the levels is accurate enough, then we increase the level and we go to the next level if needed. So the algorithm is fully adaptive in the sense that the number of samples that is needed is automatically determined. Of course, we need an initial set, but after that, the algorithm determines how many samples are needed in a parameter space, and then also the number of layers that is needed in a multi-level setting is determined automatically. Okay, this is the cost function, and so the validation error, I'm going to skip that. Let's go to some results, some test cases. This is one of the test cases that we that sounds a bit simple because this is a linear advection diffusion equation, but we wanted to test this one because it was easy to include a high dimensional parameter dependence, and of course because it's linear, we can check that our methods really, they should really work, and we can also look at theoretical convergence because our ideas that I outlined before, they are based on linearized theory. Okay, so in this case, we have a convection diffusion equation. The Reynolds number is space dependent, and this space dependence is given by this, it's a bit of an academic setting. So we use polynomials in X, and then uncertain parameters just in front of that. So this is sort of an expansion it's a bit like a random field expansion that we use. We just do this in order to be able to do a high number of uncertain parameters. If you take just a single uncertain parameter, so the number of uncertain parameters is one, then the Reynolds number is just given by Z directly. So then you have the classical convection diffusion equation. And now we can look at what the algorithm is doing. So we start at the coarsest level, that is NL equals one. We have 100 grid points, this is our choice, and we take 20 samples in parameter space. So 20 samples of the Reynolds number. We also take 20 samples of the next grid level. This is needed in order to calculate the error between the levels. And then we let the method run. So the neural network is trained, number of samples is enriched, we go to the next level, and so on and so on. And then at this point, at the fifth level, we have put in an accuracy requirement, an overall accuracy requirement of 10 to the power minus 4. And this is met on this level for over the entire range of Reynolds numbers, then a certain parameter in this case, and then we are converged, so the method stops. What is very interesting, I think, is to see that the high number of samples that we have on the coarsest grid indeed decreases rapidly when we go to finer grids. So this is this assumption of variance reduction. If you go to finer grids, so more grid points, you need less samples. So here we need quite a bit of samples, although, okay, this is one dimension, this is super simple to calculate, but on the expensive grids, the fine grids, we only need a few. So here you see how the error behaves from the coarsest grid to the finest grid. And you see indeed that every time you go to the next finer grid, the error decreases by order h squared. So it's a quadratic convergence because we use a second order method to solve this equation. Okay, this was there's one other thing I want to show, that is the error structure. So I showed you before for this backward facing step flow how this error is similar on different levels, and here we have the same results for the advection diffusion equation. So we see if we look as a function of x and Reynolds number and certain parameter, that basically this neural network mapping, which is learning the error, stays exactly the same when we increase the number of levels. So that makes the training of the subsequent networks very simple. Okay, we also compare this to what we call the state of the art, which is the multi-level stochastic collocation method from Tekentrop and others. And then we see that depending on the number of uncertain parameters, the results are similar. So for many parameters, it becomes a bit faster. But this is a very simple case. I will show you more complex cases where we really outperform the state of the art. Okay, so let's go back to the backward facing step case, the one that I already addressed before. So these are the incompressible Navier-Stokes equations. We look again at the uncertainty in the Reynolds number. So in this case, uncertainty in the Reynolds number means that this recirculation bubble in the flow, it becomes larger or smaller. And also the secondary recirculation bubble at the top, it can disappear for the lower Reynolds number. So the flow really changes in terms of its structure. we get a very similar picture as before. In this case, the algorithm determines that we need 50 samples in order to have a neural network mapping that is accurate enough between the first two grid levels. And then when we refine, we go to more number of grid points, finer levels, then we indeed see that the number of samples that is required rapidly decreases. And if we go and look at the actual performance for this case compared with the same method that I just mentioned, this multi-level stochastic collocation method, we now see that depending a bit on the accuracy that you require, our method is really competitive. So maybe on the coarsest accuracy, let's say if you just want this accuracy, it's similar, but here we really see a significant speed up. Okay, I want to end the presentation now with the sloshing case that I started the presentation with. So now things become really, let's say, nonlinear and dynamic. We solve the incompressible Navier-Stokes equations with a combined grid and particle method. So that's a so-called pick-flip solver. So there's a grid and there, in which we solve incompressibility, for example, and then the particles are used to track the free surface. Here you see two examples of the solution at two specific time instances. So this is at one time instance, and then there is the low fidelity solution and the high fidelity solution. So you see the high fidelity solution has much more details to it. And the low fidelity solution is clearly missing some features of the flow. The uncertainties that we have used as inputs are the movement of the tank. So this is also realistic in the sense that in actual practice, the tank movement, ship movement is something that is uncertain and that has a big influence on the behavior of the loading. So we used basically two angles to rotate this tank, and these rotations are used as uncertain parameters. And the quantity of interest in this case is the number of particles in each cell at this time instance. Okay, so let's look at the results. So the first thing that we observe if we look, if we go from the coarsest level to finer levels, is that we still see a strong decrease in the in the error. So the in this case, the solution of the finest level with respect to a reference solution. The number of samples decreases rapidly with the level. So we start here with a couple of hundred samples on the coarsest level, but on the fine level, so this here, it becomes expensive, but here we just need an order of 10, 20 simulations on the finest level. And now if we start to look with the what we call the state of the art, this multi-level stochastic collocation method, basically over the entire range of accuracy, we are outperforming this method. So, okay, now let's wrap up. So I presented this multi-level neural network method, which is a way to compute parametric uncertainties still by using coarse grids. And it's a non-intrusive method. So you don't need to know anything about the PDE basically. So if you are able if you have a PDE solver that gives you a quantity of interest on a grid, you're able to interpolate from coarse grid to fine grids, then basically you are in business and you can use this method. The main driver in this design of the neural network that has a convolutional part and a fully connected part is based on linear PDE theory. But I've showed with the test cases that also in the nonlinear regime, it works very well. And the main idea behind the method, apart from linearized PDE theory, is that there's a structure in the error between grid levels. Okay, of course, there's also still much to do. One thing that I didn't address is if you have quantities of interest that are time dependent. And another thing is, I showed up to 10 dimensions for the linear advection diffusion case. But if you want to go to more, then we didn't really test that. Well, at least use has tried that, but it became expensive as well. So there's definitely work to do if we want to tackle those problems. If you want to read more, then there's a version of on archive. The paper is currently, we submitted the revision to JCP. So I hope that gets accepted. If you have any questions, then please let me know.
Okay, thank you, Benjamin. We can take questions now, so just raise your hand or unmute if you want to ask something. In the meantime, can you tell me why it becomes so much more expensive if you have more than 10 parameters?
So one of the things is that you still need to sample your random space to start the algorithm.
Okay.
So here I showed, let's see if I can show one example. So here we start, for example, we start with 10 samples of the Reynolds number, and then it's just a single parameter. If you have more than 10 dimensions and you want to take 10 initial samples, in each dimension, then it already goes, it grows very fast. So I think we need to either improve our sampling strategy in high dimensional spaces. Or we need to, I don't know. Also the training of the networks gets more expensive, right? So that, that's another added difficulty.
But there's no like curse of dimensionality like in stochastic collocation where it just explodes exponentially.
There is, of course, on one hand, the algorithm is adaptive. Eh? So it determines adaptively where new sampling points, which ones are taken. But we saw from the maybe I skipped a bit over that. For the linear case, here we plot the number of uncertain parameters on the horizontal axis and the scaled computational cost to the power 1 over the number of uncertain parameters, 1 over nz. So if this is a constant, then basically you have the curse of dimensionality, if this would be 1. And then this would be a simple power law. And we are a bit below that, but still it levels off here. So they're still suffering from the curse of dimensionality, but maybe a bit less than a real power dependence.
Okay.
A real exponential dependence.
Bastian Brahms?
Yes, Benjamin, I missed something earlier. Is your Reynolds number a global constant in each calculation, or is it a Reynolds number field varying over the domain?
In the, it depends on the test case. So in this case, it's a field.
Yes.
Here, Reynolds is a function of X.
Yes.
So this is the expression. And in the other test case, the backward facing step, it's a constant. Well, okay. It's not a constant in the sense it's a parameter, but it's not
spatial. It's a parameter, yeah, but it's one parameter.
Yeah.
It's one parameter. But when it's a field,
yeah,
then I would think you're in a more than 10-dimensional space already.
Can you say again?
If it's a field, then it has as many parameters as you have cells in your grid. So you quickly have more than 10 parameters.
No, that's not the case because of this expansion.
Oh, okay.
You can see my mouse.
Yeah,
so it's basically basis x to the power j times an uncertain parameter. So that gives you the spatial dependence.
Yeah. Fine. Yeah.
All right. Some other questions, perhaps?
Other question.
It's Paula? Hi, Benjamin. I have a question concerning the sloshing case we showed in at the end.
Yeah.
You are saying that in this case you have a your QE. Okay, it's number of particle. But when you train the network, do you need to provide space and time samples, or what are you providing to the neural network for the training in this case? Because the solution is time dependent, right?
The solution is time dependent, but in this case, we looked at the QOI as the number of particles in each cell at a specific time instance.
Okay, so you train the network just to estimate the error for this QOI. It's not an
indeed. Yeah.
Okay.
So that is definitely a shortcoming. So for time dependent, that's why I put here in the conclusions that for time dependent QOIs is something to work on. So we, in this case, basically what you get is a neural network that is accurate at in getting the QOI at this time instance.
Okay.
So you can either say, okay, I'm going to repeat that and do it for multiple time instances and train again. But that can become quite expensive. Mm. Another way to do it is to take a quantity which is actually less than you would think, because I think about in the end they're often interested in an integrated quantity. So what is the average load over a certain period of time? Well, for example, the average load over over 10 seconds or something like that. So then you have a quantity of interest that becomes time independent, and then you can still apply the technique. Another way I think to do it is to do some sort of dimension reduction in time to a principal component analysis of your output or something like that. So these are all things that we did not consider yet, but those are possibilities maybe.
And maybe if I may, another question, but this is common maybe to your method and to all multi-level methods, because you say that the number of samples for each level is chosen arbitrarily, right? So for instance, you choose to put 20 samples for the coarser grid and then another 20 samples, and then you go to, I don't know, 10 and then 4, etc. But do you check that the Monte Carlo sampling is converged for each level or not? Because you choose 20 samples, but maybe you could try to increase the number of samples, have sort of stock criterion to check if you have enough sample for each level?
Yes, we do that. So let me see, where is the first? So in this case, the linear case, we start with 10 samples on the courses grid, but it is not enough. So we set an accuracy and then it determines that we need 20.
Okay.
So actually there are sort of two tolerances. You can see it in the flow chart. So there is the training of a neural network for a specific level for which we have a tolerance, and then we have an overall tolerance that we want to achieve.
Okay.
And so within the training of this network, we check if we achieve a certain accuracy, and if not, we enlarge the sample set.
Okay.
So
indeed you observe that on the finer grids you need less samples than on the coarser one.
Yeah, it comes out of the method basically of the algorithm. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
All right, some other questions? Dan, I think you had one, or somebody else?
So my question was pretty much the same as the first question just now by Paola Sinella about the time dependence case. So that's pretty much answered. Thanks.
Okay. I did this in 15 minutes at SIAM, CSE. No, I removed a lot of stuff, right? This was the extended version. So.
Anybody else want to ask a last question? Because if not, I'd like to thank Benjamin for a nice presentation. And thank you all for coming. And the next talk...
Organizing, Martin.
No worries. Next talk is going to be in 2 weeks again from Julia, also from CWR. So thank you all, and see you next time.
Thanks, both.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.